working with today. I liken the assignment to the assignment undertaken by Nehemiah in the Bible, who in 52 days rebuilt the broken walls of Jerusalem. Government College Omaha Old Boys have 52 weeks to rebuild the broken down Government College Omaha. We can do it because the plan is to restart our alma mater as a great school in September 2020. And I look forward to working with all of us on this exciting project. It will be tasking. We all need to mobilize resources from ourselves, but I believe it will be exciting also because we have longed for this day when we can actually rebuild Government College Omaha. Thank you for listening.
I was in the library and I saw on the desk where I saw the inscription Chinua Achebe, and I was struck. I just want to know, at that time in our country, what did it feel like to be a student of Gombe College? I mean, there must have been excellence that brought you there. What about inside you as a student? Was there any peculiar feeling going to a school like Government College at that time, you know, 47, 48, whatever that was?
Oh yes, it was to go to Government College of Mary. In our time, the class was an average of 30 people in the whole class. And even then, most classes didn't have the full complement of 30. Because of one thing or the other. Somebody might be sick, I'm not sure. The class will be about 29, 28. And there's some places were reserved for Cameroonians. And once or twice, they could not meet their quota. And by the time they could not meet their quota, the school had already started. So it was prestigious to go to my. Many of us took entrance to two or three secondary schools. And if you passed to my, you forgot the others. But then, when we got in, we were not proud at all. There was no showmanship. In fact, if you boasted to other schools, apart from joking with your friends, you were punished. So we were very, very modest. In my own case, if I can take it as an example, I passed entrance to Umaya from standard 6. In that time, you had to take the entrance from standard 6. And I passed entrance to Okreka Grammar School, which was the best Anglican, the best secondary school at that time by the Anglican Church. I passed the two. Then I was offered a scholarship by the Anglican Church to choose between the Africa, Priscilla Grammar School, and DNGS, the because the paper was the same, the exam was the same. The same exam paper for the grammar schools. So I was rejoicing that I won a scholarship and I wanted to go to DMJS. But when I told my father, he said, no, you'll go to mine. So his neighbors from Enugu and Agena and Ojiobu and all those people from Anambra who were living in Kantola in Port Harcourt. He said, look at this foolish man. He wants to go and pay fees when they say he can go to DMJS without paying fees for that. My father insisted that I go to mine, that he will pay. Because I passed as a fee-paying student to mine. Well, my classmate and best friend, the late Michael Majiku, who became a professor in Fulton.
Okay.
He lectured at Nsukka. He set up the electrical engineering laboratory. He was always beating me in primary school. And both of us were the only ones who passed from the whole of our bar center.
Ooh.
And went to Maya together, and we're also in the same class. And we're sitting side by side at St. Michael's School at Bar. We're sitting side by side. Government College of Maya, we're sitting by side. He won a scholarship, open scholarship, what was called exhibition scholarship. In the whole of Owerri province, he came first. So, in spite of that, my father told me to go to mine.
There is something I am wondering if you missed out. So I'd like to ask you if the spirit of competition that I met in Government College Jumaya, because our numbers were higher and our teachers were fewer. And we knew we had an obligation to still keep the flag of the school flying. So we tasked ourselves to ensure that we still kept the records of the school. So I am wondering if the competitive spirit that was evident in our time because of the reduced resources by way of facilities and teachers, whether it was there in your time. Because in our time, which was immediately after the war and thereafter, that was especially the driving force. But I remember hearing that Chinua Achebe, of blessed memory, despite having made the best result in his set, felt bad that a certain Essien or so, who eventually read medicine, beat him in literature. So he didn't mind being beaten in any other subject but literature. And in our time, if somebody beat you in one subject or two subjects, the next exam you would struggle and struggle to ensure you beat him back. Did that spirit pervade your circumstances in your time also?
Certainly no. Mm-hmm. Certainly no. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether Chinua Achebe was 4 years my senior.
Okay. Okay.
I thought he was in the same class as one Donatus Okan. But I'm not sure. I don't know whether it was 1 year his junior or 1 year his senior. I don't think it could have been a senior because I think Donatus Okan was among the highest people at that time. The reason I mention this is that Donatus Okan was always beating everybody in his class. And while we were there, Okay, let me now make a comment. There was no interpersonal
rivalry.
No. All we were concerned with was everybody wanted to pass in grade one. So you worked there to pass in grade one. And you should know that up to the 23rd year of Omaha, nobody ever faced school certificate. And up to 25th year, civil anniversary, the school never recorded a grade three. Everybody passed in grade one or grade two. And on the average, my class was only 26 people.
26? Well, because of the shortfalls here and there.
Yeah.
Because you said 30 was normal.
Yes, 30 is the intake. Yes. So we were 26. I think about 20 people were in grade one and 6 in grade two. And then in literature and English, I think we had about 24 A's and maybe 22 A's and four B's.
Incredible.
In literature.
So, like I stated earlier, I belong to class 72. During our time,
yes,
the standard of discipline was high, very high then. It was high then, just a few years after the Civil War. Can you tell us or share with us what the life was during their own time in terms of discipline?
I think I could bet my bottom dollar or bottom naira that the discipline in your time was not up to 60% of the discipline in that time. Were you all body students?
Yes, we
are. Where, sir?
Up to 70. Up to 1970. We were body.
No, studentship came up far after.
Okay. The decision might be comparable. I thought you had some day students. That's why you made a statement.
Sir?
The discipline at then was rock solid. And it was, everybody enjoyed it. That's the funny thing.
Onions didn't, sir.
We didn't complain at all. We didn't complain about it. For instance, there were defined periods where you must not study.
Yes.
No textbook, you must read novels. And in our time, we had a minimum number of novels you were to read and summarize the story and submit to the principal. I mean, to your English masters. Novels that had nothing to do with school certificates, just for interest.
Yes. Yeah. I think we never had such experience. We didn't.
Well, I mean, most people were interested ordinarily. Most people in reading novels, that used to be the topic of conversation. Yeah, but we had something called fast motion.
Lights out.
Was that there when you were fast motion? Right after the bell, after dining hall, you had to be moving. Remember, fast motion.
Fast motion, yes. There will be no slow motion.
No slow motion. My wife keeps on telling me, slow down again.
Do you mean motion or movement?
Movement between when you're moving from class to class, you have to walk briskly.
And to be seen to be walking briskly by the giving rods.
But we didn't have that.
Okay, but that fast.
We didn't have that in my time. I'm not even sure if we had it in your time.
And finally, sir, what pieces of advice we want to give to this present day Omayans, driving home their points with practical examples?
Well, the only advice I could give them is that they must think in terms of in anything you do, you must think in terms of the excellence of Omaha. All those excellent ideas and thoughts and pursuits and objectives which were drummed into us when we were two men. Anything you do, you must aim to be excellent in it. If you are playing soccer, you must work hard, practice hard, to be as good as you can in soccer. If you are in if you are studying English, you must make sure you study it and deal with English the way the white tall Englishman will handle it. Things like Nigerian English have no place in the system. Many of us were speaking more phonetically than we do now, when we're told my far more phonetically. And when we studied abroad, those of us who studied abroad, we came back speaking at least 70% like Englishmen. But when you stay in Nigeria for a very long time, you are bound to lose. I lost all my own.
Now, let's ask some more from that. Yes, please, sir. Sometimes I have the feeling that government college did not prepare us for Nigeria.
Did not remember?
Prepare us for Nigeria. I have seen those in government college who decided to stay on abroad. They are all in their element. And I've seen even our seniors, both ancient and modern, the way they conduct themselves here, because government college did not teach us to be unduly aggressive and uncouth in our behavior. And it has been a liability in this place. All of us are similar. You see us, we don't like to be in the hurly-burly, disturbing people, coming to an office when you're not invited. We have lots of delicate mannerisms that we have carried with us from government college. Honestly, without exception, all of us, that's why sometimes we are not where the ovation is loudest, or you won't hear that we have done some big jobs or follow politicians around because of the way we were brought up. And increasingly, the way the country is now, it almost seems as if it's a liability. Indeed, my favorite language is that Omoyans are like dinosaurs in present-day Nigeria. I'd like you to throw a little bit of light on how people like us are to manage in such a country where people don't even observe basic cordiality and respect to others. How have you managed to achieve success in your own area, being an Omoyan? I've seen one or two things that even since we came here that confirms me that these are the Omoyans of the old stock, sir. How have you managed?
Yes. You predicated that they did not prepare us for Nigeria. The Nigeria of my time is not the Nigeria of your time. The Nigeria of my time was totally colonial. So they prepared us the way they would prepare the English student in England. Yes. They prepared us to observe British civic systems, British way of doing things.
Yes.
We were told, don't give false evidence against your friend, don't tell tales, don't listen to tale bearers. If somebody tells you, I know did so and so that was negative, you ask him, did you see him do such a thing? If you say somebody told you, then you become almost a non-person because that's stupid. So if somebody tells you a story against somebody else, you must tell that fellow to call that fellow and both of you will tell me the issues. Otherwise, you threaten him, okay, I'm going to tell this fellow that he says such a thing to me about him. Will you be prepared to defend what he said? So we are brought up to be like the English, the white or Englishman, that means the colonial governing group. Whitehall Englishman is the civil servant in England. We were trained to be strictly honest, observe integrity, and be friendly to everybody. And that was my time. This, what is happening in Nigeria for the recent decades? It didn't happen. That way. So we are not given to hustling.
That's the word.
Sir. Yeah, we're not given to hustling.
People are not hustlers.
We're not given to promoting ourselves.
No.
We're not given to greed. And you'll find that old boys of Omaha, no matter how high the position they occupied, they remained modest. Even if they were to do crooked, a few crooked things, they would do it maybe to about, they don't do it even, they can't observe it, they can't commit a crime. 10% to the extent, maybe others will commit it. And I'll give you an illustration. Four old boys have been group managing directors of NNPC. Almost every time, the NNPC group managing director will be indicted of one thing or the other, and even jailed. Not one of those four was ever. No scandal was spread against him.
Right. Let me add another one. I agree completely with you that Government College Umuahia of your time groomed you to suit into and serve the Nigeria of your time. And in that tradition, those of us far behind you were also similarly groomed. The only thing is that the Nigeria we met after the
Civil War
was not the kind of Nigeria you will have. And I think that's what my friend Joe is talking about, that we appear disadvantaged. But I still do not see it as some loss, because at all times after, there is still something remarkable about Umuahians when they come on stage and exit the stage. There's usually a difference. So I don't think we really should be despondent, because everything doesn't have to go the present or current Nigerian way, where you use the proper word to illustrate hustling. We don't have to be hustlers. There has to be some finesse about us, and there has to be something ascribable to us by way of capacity and capability. So I will diverge a little bit. You are aware that the school is being restored. The school, there's an attempt by old boys to restore the school to what it was that gave it the kind of name that has persevered. And there were practices in Government College Umuahia that I think shaped the kind of discipline that you talked about. Regimentation and regulation, where the order was placed and the ranking was there. You had to pay obeisance to your seniors, and in that order, our maxim then was obey before complain. And my two questions are this: what was it like? Was there tail cutting in your time, and what was it like? And how do you think it will fit into the restored Umuahia that we have received? Do you think those practices should be kept for the sustenance of the traditional discipline that we have, the discipline that we are associated with? Do you think such practices should be sustained, or do you think we should lose them to modernity? And how do you think it plays out?
Yes. have to say something. I can't. They got the same school. I bought a third bank. In my hatchet, in my car school line. No, God was there, I have changed in number time. I thought I had to get the detective on that bounty. So that Jesus Christ will know. Amen.
The
number is
85
But since I became a knight,
don't take it.
But the younger person should pass it for too long.
To be chronicled, a government college room I have, Old Boys Association magazine on television. In this episode, I have two great Umayyads in the house, Dr. K.D. Chukwukere and Mr. Chudi Onuzo, all to be chronicled on their memorable events while in school. Who said I'm not excited? I am, because today I'll be privileged to drink from the fountain of knowledge. I also have in the house Yoweri Axis chapter, led by its able chairman, Engineer Emma Nyamu, and also my brother Joe Mweke is in the house too. I am Victor Okoro, class 72 in my house, your uncle and chronic lab. Gome College Umuahia, founded 1929, is a foremost citadel of learning east of the Niger. This college, whose first principal was Reverend Robert Fisher, is known for its academic excellence from inception to the present day, churning out quality and brilliant minds who have made and will continue to make indelible marks in their chosen fields of endeavor in terms of achievement by excellence in the Nigerian society and even beyond the shores of Nigeria. Notable men, men of exceptional qualities, men of timber and caliber, men whose extraordinary intelligent quotient would have taken this country out of its doldrum if their services were valued and employed. Government College Umuahia, no doubt, is a reservoir of great minds who are knowledgeable and vast in both ancient and contemporary events, and also wielding ideas, intelligence, and charisma that can, to a large extent, evolve solutions to the present-day problems of Nigeria and beyond. As part of this great and noble institution of international repute, I will not hesitate to chronicle the achievements of these great Umuahians, kickstarting with Dr. Edi Chukwukere and Barrister Chudi Onuzo. Dr. Chukwukere is an engineer by profession, a can-do engineer, not a paper engineer. A man of excellence. I'm going to start off the question this way. Sir, I am the most privileged younger Umuahians to drink from the fountain of your knowledge as an ancient school boy. Kindly share with me one of your memorable events in your early days in school.
One of my memorable events. As you go to
so many.
But the one I remember the most is the college son, the college entry. We were given an impromptu test at preparatory class one afternoon, 1.5 hour prep class. And the test was just one question. The master was Mr. Charles Lowe, an Australian teacher in English. The question was, write any poem on any topic on with Trochee or iambic tetrameter.
Wow.
In Trochee or iambic tetrameter, these are meters describing the rhythm in a poem. And these two are the most elementary rhythms. Iambus says, tetam, when you write the poem, it will sound like tetam, 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 tetam. Trochee says, tam, tetam, 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 in short, the reverse. We have 1.5 hours to write the poem. I just read the 4 stanzas within that 1.5 hours. I thought nothing of it until the master, Charles Lowe, came by the following day, waving my copy of the poem. So he came to me and said, look, tell me the truth, how you wrote this poem. I mean, where you copied this poem from. I told him, there's no question of copying because we didn't even know that you give us a test on poetry.
Yes.
But I chose the college motto in Udum Bukayan. May this shine as one. No. In Unum Lucant meant, may they shine in one.
In one.
So I use that as the topic of the poem. I just wrote the poem. Mr. Lowe kept going everywhere, told me again, he came back to me, after consulting a lot of people, he came back to me and said, look, you are getting your 20/20, 100% for the poem. Even if you copied it, just tell me where you copied it from. And he repeated the same answer. And then he said, I believe you. Then he ran to the principal and showed him the poem. The principal was excited and he told his wife to come and persuade me to disclose where I copied the poem. But because the wife liked me a lot, she was a mathematics master.
Okay.
And she was a graduate of Cambridge.
Wow.
Even the principal was a graduate of Cambridge. Mr. Lowe was a graduate of Oxford. And the two of them were always fighting which university was the best. Now, Mrs. Simpson came and talked to me. I went back to the husband and I said, he wrote everything. And that was close. But it did not become the college anthem until I left the school.
Wow.
It was 2 years after I left the school.
Who was responsible?
So that was my most memorable incident. The second one was, of course, the day I won my boxing colors.
Wow.
Okay, sir. Prior to this year, when writing, was there no school anthem in existence then?
No, there was none. There was none. But I wrote the poem in class 2 or class 3.
I have one other question for you. The name Government College Umuahia is synonymous with academic excellence, going by the antecedents of school certificate results, that is, start ranging from when it was Cambridge, WAEC, and so on and so forth. This has been very consistent. What, if I may ask, is responsible?
Two things, in my opinion, were responsible. One, the ratio of master to student was very low. one master to about 14, to about 14, 15 students. In other words, the school was very well staffed. In my time, we had 8 white masters and 6 black masters. We refer to our tutors as masters, not tutors or teachers. Second point was that the discipline there was very, very strict. It was modeled after the public schools in England, Eton and Harrow. Therefore, the quality of teaching was very, very high.
I remember once I was in the library and I saw on the desk where I saw the inscription Chinua Achebe, and I was struck. I just want to know, at that time in our country, what did it feel like to be a student of Gombe College? I mean, there must have been excellence that brought you there. What about inside you as a student? Was there any peculiar feeling going to a school like Gombe College at that time, you know, 47, 48, and thereabouts?
Well, yes, it was to go to Gombe College of Mary. In our time, the class was an average of 30 people in the whole class. And even then, most classes didn't have the full complement of 30. Because of one thing or the other. Somebody might be sick, I'm not sure. The class will be about 29, 28. And there's some places were reserved for Cameroonians. And once or twice, they could not meet their quota. And by the time they could not meet their quota, the school had already started. So it was prestigious to go to my. Many of us took entrance to 2 or 3 secondary schools. And if you passed to my, you forgot the others. But then, when we got in, we were not proud at all. There was no showmanship. In fact, if you boasted to other schools, apart from joking with your friends, you were punished. So we were very, very modest. In my own case, if I can take it as an example, I passed entrance to Umuahia from Standard 6. In our time, we had to take the entrance from Standard 6. And I passed entrance to Akreka Grammar School, which was the best Anglican, the best secondary school at that time by the Anglican Church. I passed it too. Then I was offered a scholarship by the Anglican Church to choose between the Africa, Priscilla Grammar School, and DNGS. Because the paper was the same, the exam was the same exam paper for the grammar schools. So I was rejoiced that I won a scholarship and I wanted to go to DMGS. But when I told my father, he said, no, you'll go to mine. So his neighbors from Enugu and Agena, Ojiogu and all those people from Anambra who were living in Port Harcourt, He said, look at this foolish man. He wants to go and pay fees, but then they say he can go to D&D without paying fees. My father insisted that I go to mine, that he will pay. Because I passed as a fee-paying student to mine. Well, my classmate and best friend, the late Michael Majiku, who became a professor in Fute,
okay.
He lectured at Nsukka. He set up the engineering, electrical engineering laboratory. He was always beating me in primary school, and both of us were the only ones who passed from the whole of our bar center.
Ooh.
And went to Maya together, and we were also in the same class. And we were sitting side by side at St. Michael's School at Aba. We were sitting side by side. Government College of Maya, we were sitting by side. He won a scholarship, open scholarship, what was called exhibition scholarship. In the whole of Owerri province, he came first. So, in spite of that, my father told me to go to Maya.
Something I am wondering if you missed out. So I'd like to ask you if the spirit of competition that I met in Government College Jumaya, because our numbers were higher and our teachers were fewer. And we knew we had an obligation to still keep the flag of the school flying. So we tasked ourselves to ensure that we still kept the records of the school. So I am wondering if the competitive spirit that was evident in our time because of the reduced resources by way of facilities and teachers, whether it was there in your time. Because in our time, which was immediately after the war and thereafter, that was especially the driving force. But I remember hearing that Chinua Achebe, of blessed memory, despite having made the best result in his set, felt bad that a certain Essien or so, who eventually read medicine, beat him in literature. So he didn't mind being beaten in any other subject but literature. And in our time, if somebody beat you in one subject or two subjects, the next exam you would struggle and struggle to ensure you beat him back. Did that spirit pervade your circumstances in your time also?
Certainly no. Certainly no. I don't know whether June Achebe was 4 years my senior.
Okay.
I thought he was in the same class as one Donatus Opera. But I'm not sure. I don't know whether it was 1 year his junior or 1 year his senior. I don't think he could have been a senior because I think Donatus Opera was among the highest people at that time. The reason I mentioned this is that Donatus Opera was always beating everybody in his class.
Including
while we were there, let me not make a comment on that. There was no interpersonal
rivalry.
No. Okay. All we were concerned with was everybody wanted to pass in grade one. So you worked there to pass in grade one. And you should know that up to the 23rd year of Omai, nobody ever failed school certificate. And up to 20, 50 years, civil and industrial, nobody, the school never recorded a grade 3. Everybody passed in grade 1 or grade 2. And on the average, my class was only 26 people.
26?
26.
Well, because of the shortfalls here and there.
Yeah.
Because you said 30 was normal.
Yes, 30 is the intake. Yes. So we were 26. I think about 20 people were in grade 1 and 6 in grade 2. And then in literature and English, we were in literature, I think we had about 24 A's and two, maybe 22 A's and four B's.
Incredible.
In literature.
So, like I stated earlier, I belong to class 72. During our time,
yes,
the standard of discipline was high, very high then. It was high then, just a few years after the Civil War. Can you tell us, or share with us, what the life was during your own time in terms of discipline?
I think I could bet my bottom dollar or bottom naira that the discipline in your time was not up to 60% of the discipline in our time. Were you all body students?
Yes, we are.
Where, sir?
Up to 70. Up to 1970. We are boarding.
The studentship came up far after.
Okay. The decision might be comparable. I thought you had some day students. That's why I made the statement.
Sir?
The discipline at them was rock solid. And it was, everybody enjoyed it. That's the funny thing.
Onions didn't, sir.
We didn't complain at all. We didn't complain about it. For instance, there were defined periods where you must not study.
Yes.
No textbook, you must read novels. And in our time, we had a minimum number of novels you were to read and summarize the story and submit to the principal, to your English masters. Novels that had nothing to do with school certificates, just for interest.
Yes. Yeah. I think we never had such experience.
Most people were interested on that. Most people in the novels, that used to be the topic of conversation. Yeah. But we had something called fast motion.
Lights out.
Was that there when you were fast motion? Right after the bell for school, after dining hall, you had to be moving. Remember,
fast motion. Yes, there will be no slow motion.
No slow motion. My wife keeps on telling me, Joe, slow down again.
Kevin, do you mean motion or movement?
Movement between, when you're moving from class to class, you have to walk briskly. And to be seen to be walking briskly by the giving rods.
We didn't have that.
Okay, but we had fast
motion. We didn't have that in my time. I'm not even sure if we had it in your time.
And finally, sir, what pieces of advice do you want to give to this present day Omaya, driving home the points with practical examples?
Well, the only advice I could give them is that they must think in terms of in anything you do, you must think in terms of the excellence of woman. All those excellent ideas and thoughts and pursuits and objectives which were drummed into us where we're too many. Anything you do, you must aim to be excellent in it. If you are playing soccer, you must work hard, practice hard, to be as good as you can in soccer. If you are studying English, you must make sure you study it and deal with English the way the white tall Englishman will handle it. Things like Nigerian English have no place in the system. Many of us were speaking more phonetically than we do now, when we were 2 miles, far more phonetically. And when we studied abroad, those of us who studied abroad, we came back speaking at least 70% like Englishmen. But when you stay in Nigeria for a very long time, you are bound to lose. I lost all my own.
Now, let's ask some more for that. Yes, please, sir. Sometimes I have the feeling that government college did not prepare us for Nigeria.
You don't remember?
Prepare us for Nigeria. I have seen those in government college who decided to stay on abroad. They are all in their element. And I've seen even our seniors, both ancient and modern, the way they conduct themselves here, because government college did not teach us to be unduly aggressive and uncouth in our behavior. And it has been a liability in this place. All of us are similar. You see us, we don't like to be in the hurly-burly, disturbing people, coming to an office when you're not invited. We have lots of delicate mannerisms that we have carried with us from government college. Honestly, without exception, all of us. That's why sometimes we are not where the ovation is loudest, or you won't hear that we have done some big jobs or follow politicians around because of the way we're brought up. And increasingly, the way the country is, it almost seems as if it's a liability. Indeed, my favorite language is that Omuahians are like dinosaurs in present-day Nigeria. I'd like you to throw a little bit of light on how people like us are to manage in such a country where people don't even observe basic cordiality and respect to others. How have you managed to achieve success in your own area, being an Omuahian? I've seen one or two things that even since we came here that confirms me that these are Omuahians of the old stock, sir. How have you managed?
Yes. You predicted that they did not prepare us for Nigeria. The Nigeria of my time is not the Nigeria of your time. The Nigeria of my time was totally colonial. So they prepared us the way they would prepare the English student in England.
Yes.
They prepared us to observe British civic systems, British way of doing things.
Yes.
We were told, don't give false evidence against your friend, don't tell tales, don't listen to tale bearers. If somebody tells you, I know we did so and so that was negative, you ask him, did you see him do such a thing? If you say somebody told you, then you become almost a non-person because that's stupid. So if somebody tells you a story against somebody else, you must tell that fellow to call that fellow and both of you will tell me the issues. Otherwise, you threaten him, okay, I'm going to tell this fellow that he says such a thing to me about him. Will you be prepared to defend what he said? So we are brought up to be like the English, the Whitehall Englishman, that means the colonial governing group. Whitehall Englishman is the civil servant in England. We were trained to be strictly honest, observe integrity, and be friendly to everybody. And that was my time. This what is happening in Nigeria for the recent decades, it didn't happen that way. So we are not given to hustling.
That's the word, sir.
Yeah, we're not given to
hustling. People are not hustlers.
We're not given to promoting ourselves.
No.
We're not given to greed.
It's okay. Not hustlers.
So, and you'll find that old boys of Omaha, no matter how high the position they occupied, they remained modest. Even if they were to do crooked, a few crooked things, they would do it maybe to about, they're not doing it even, they can't observe it, they can't commit a crime. 10% to the extent, maybe others will commit it. And I'll give you an illustration. Four old boys had been group managing directors of an NPC. Almost every time, an NPC group managing director would be indicted of one thing or the other, and even guilty. Not one of those four was ever, no scandal was spread against them. Wow.
Let me add another one. I agree completely with you that Government College Umuahia of your time groomed you to suit into and serve the Nigeria of your time. And in that tradition, those of us far behind you were also similarly groomed. The only thing is that the Nigeria we met after the
Civil War
was not the kind of Nigeria you will have. And I think that's what my friend Joe is talking about, that we appear disadvantaged. But I still do not see it as some loss, because at all times after, there is still something remarkable about Umuahians. When they come on stage and exit the stage, there's usually a difference. So I don't think we really should be despondent, because everything doesn't have to go the present or current Nigerian way, where you use the proper word to illustrate hustling. We don't have to be hustlers. There has to be some finesse about us, and there has to be something ascribable to us by way of capacity and capability. So I will diverge a little bit. You are aware that the school is being restored. The school, there's an attempt by old boys to restore the school to what it was that gave it the kind of name that has persevered. And there were practices in Government College Umuahia that I think shaped the kind of discipline that you talked about. Regimentation and regulation, where the order was placed and the ranking was there. You had to pay obeisance to your seniors, and in that order, our maxim then was obey before complain. And my two questions are this: what was it like? Was there tail cutting in your time, and what was it like? And how do you think it will fit into the restored Umuahia that we have received? Do you think those practices should be kept for the sustenance of the traditional discipline that we have, the discipline that we are associated with? Do you think such practices should be sustained, or do you think we should lose them to modernity? And how do you think it plays out?
Yes.
Wait.
Okay, sir. He's ready for you.
That's a very good point you made. I think that everything about that should be retained. I tell you why. All those things were to prove that you must give deference to your seniors. Everybody that is superior to you in rank or office, you must obey him, unless what he's telling you is against intelligent thinking. In which case you said, excuse me, please, I do not agree with what you're telling me. But Tatu Maya, the principal emphasized obey before complaint.
Obey.
Obey before complaint. And I was one of those who found it very difficult to do. And for that I was punished. And the Christopher Okibo was like that. Christopher Okibo befriended me because I defied a very senior boy who was very unkind to me.
We're both of your classmates, you know.
Who?
Yes. Christopher was.
Christopher Okibo was 2 years my senior.
Okay.
And Chinua Achebe was 2 years his Christopher's his senior.
And they were great friends.
They're very good friends. But actually, I didn't know that in school. Because there was no proper interaction between seniors and juniors.
Oh.
But Christopher Okibo became very, very friendly with me by happenstance. In my first year in school, I think it was Easter time, we had an indoor games competition throughout the school. Indoor games. Chess, Ludo, snakes and ladders, drafts, and that type of what sort of games. And there was one Oma. One Oma.
Junior Oma.
I don't know whether he became an engineer. But he must be. Who was a classmate with Junior Jimmy? One man, others. So he was the school champion year in, year out. They say he was the school champion.
That is Oba.
In draft playing. So this year, when I came in, the finalists became Oba and Chibuke. A class one boy. Oba felt insulted. But he thought he would have
just pushed free, yes.
An easy win.
Yes.
The winner was to be the first to get three. The best of three games.
Yes.
Three times. Just like tennis, long tennis.
Yes.
I beat Oba.
Hey!
Now, when it appeared that I will win, the news got around, and people from the other, watching the other things, trooped in here, and the hall was full. It was in the assembly hall. And Junior Achebe came there with Chris Okibo and the Man Obasi. And the
Man Obasi.
And one Ozibu, you must have heard his name, he was a wonderful sprinter.
Yeah.
Was a wonderful sprinter in school.
He was
a sprinter.
Okay.
The engineer. Engineer. So when I beat Man Ozibu, there was a big shout. And the man gave me a terrible crack on the head. And I started crying. And when I stood up, you want to give me another crack? Then Chris Okibo came in between and pushed him aside. You can't do that. Chris told him.
Wow.
And that was almost like sacrilege that you won a senior, somebody 2 years senior to you, in the presence of other senior people,
yes.
And junior people. Chris practically pushed him aside and helped me and comforted me. So about 13 years of people, he assaulted your senior. He said, you're not senior on this occasion because you have let yourself down. And then I was staying ready clean on one of his classmates. And he and the children were still laughing at him. That was I was surprised that Chris of people whom I didn't know defended me so well.
Yes.
So that was the
beginning of your friendship with him.
And only to discover that Pius of people is oldest brother. had known him when I was in elementary school.
How?
He was the first Nigerian district officer to be appointed before independence. And he was stationed at Aban. Now, my father was a money lender. And he was a litigant. He had to take people who couldn't pay to court very often.
Yes.
And the district officer has had to attend court in some of the cases. And that was where I go to court. That was where Pius Okibo met me. And Pius Okibo used to give me some letters to go and deliver for him. You know. So now I came to my, and his younger brother became my friend as well.
Amazing.
That was quite intriguing.
Okay.
Wait.
Dr. Edith Chukwukere is an engineer by profession, an icon of excellence, a man of many parts, a successful man in all spheres of life. I want him to tell me about the Ogunigwe during the Civil War and about the book he's writing now.
The Ogunigwe. Everybody who took part in research on armaments production, which we call RAP, became a local champion of having manufactured the Ogunigwe. If I go to my home and the topic arose about how we manufacture weapons, all my home people say, Chukwukere manufactured the Ogunigwe, manufactured that. If you go to Anambra, even the remotest place in Anambra, they tell you, there are man there. A boy with man, but not a Ogunigwe. You go to Port Harcourt, you get the same thing. The Ogunigwe people, they say they manufacture the Ogunigwe. But I can tell you with authority, because I was the head of the military wing of RAP, that maintained discipline in the whole RAP, that provided security to the whole, all the RAP groups. I provided soldiers to guard RAP stations. I provided soldiers to escort people to take the weapons to the war front. So I was the only person in the whole RAP who could visit all the groups, whether they were in Item, whether they were in Agoda, where they were in Aguilera, you know. I was the only soldier, a regular soldier in the whole RAP. There were many other people started as colonels, lieutenant colonels in RAP, but that was they were civilians, given protective clothing and that rank.
Okay.
So in case they had to move towards dangerous areas. Now, the Ogunigwe, some books have been published, some jobs claiming that they, in fact, some even the concept was provided by them. That is not true. The Ogunigwe was conceived and designed by only one person, William Oddly Achuku of Onitsha. Nobody contributed anything. I worked closely with him from day one to the end of the war. The guy was a genius. He could make anything. Anything that pertained to steel, he would come to me and ask for which steel to use. So the Ogunigwe was not built by any group or team. It was an invention. A team cannot invent something unless through research. Unless through research group. It was an invention. It was only by him. Nobody else contributed their time. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Yeah. you are cook.
Okay.
Well, maybe further on the war.
My pardon?
Further on the war.
Yeah.
Here.
You want me to answer the second part of the question?
Let him answer the second.
At no time did I decide to write a book. In fact, I did not believe I would survive the war because of the nature of my work. I had to visit every war front, to deliver special weapons to them. Now, because of the association of Emmanuel Ifeanyi, we carried out a coup using crack-made mortars and mortar bombs. I got a signal from government house through the principal staff officer to Juku, Colonel Mwebosi, Emmanuel Mwebosi. They said it to RAP and said that from now on, all mortars and mortar bombs can only be delivered to the war front, to any commander, by Edward Chukwu by name, soon, nobody else. So that if there was any confusion, I'd be the person to be one. Before that, I was sending my boys, the soldiers. I was head of about 200 troops, the military wing. I sent one captain and one lieutenant, take this to Captain Amadi, Brigadier Amadi, take this to Sudan, so take this to Sudan. So now I had to go myself.
What was your rank then, sir?
I was major.
Okay. Why did they have such confidence in you?
Pardon?
And why did they have such confidence to say only you?
Who have any confidence?
I mean, the government house who said this. The
government house did not have a rank, what rank was it? RAP was not set up, like many people have said, was not set up by government.
So he's asking, why did they have so much confidence in you?
No, they didn't have confidence in me. I was the only military man in RAP.
Okay. Yeah.
I was the only person who could go to war fronts.
Okay.
The head of RAP, the civilian head of RAP, Ben Moose, Dr. Moose, even Willie Ajibu himself, who manufactured about 80% of RAP weapons, he could not go to the war front. Because I was an officer.
Okay.
I was the only military officer, properly regular officer in the old branch. So they said that I was not only that, okay. A second reason was that I manufactured the first mortar. And I manufactured the first mortar bomb.
The first mortar bomb.
The first mortar barrel and the first mortar bomb. I manufactured.
Both the weapon itself and the delivery system.
The barrel and the bomb.
The shell.
The mortar shell is also called mortar bomb.
Loaded it with ordnance. You did that from just what was available then in Biafra?
From scrap.
Scrap.
You made the steel.
Yes.
You cast it into the shell. Yes. And then the priming system was done by William Chukwu. William was a wonderful person. Even after some time, after he had studied how I made the mortar and I made the hand grenade, the first hand grenade.
Wow.
Yourself.
Because this is easy to make, just by casting the liquid steel into molds with a pattern which is destructible, resembling the original weapon.
You had a foundry or a foundry where you were doing this
thing? Well, we used the railway workshops.
Okay.
And the railway workshops in Port Harcourt.
Okay.
The one in Enugu was the most highly equipped. And then there was a NPA, Nigerian Ports Authority workshop in Port Harcourt.
Okay.
Those were the only three places that had furnaces that could melt steel.
Wow.
So if anybody told you he made a hand grenade or he made a mortar bomb, if you didn't make it in Enugu or Port Harcourt Railway workshop or in Ports Authority, you know it's telling lies.
Sorry, I didn't really want to hear, but if they were only made in these three workshops you talked about, How did you get supplies after Otago fell? And I understand there was a ramification at Abidemi, because we were at Osiyotu, the voice of Nigeria. How did you get supplies when you stopped making them?
No, what did you say about the Abidemi?
They said there was a ramp.
At the ramp station there.
Yeah, we have more than 40 ramp stations.
So what I'm saying, if the bombs and the grenades were made only in these three workshops, so how did you continue to have them after
Potagata? We passively produced them. So even after Potagata, we have thousands of those. They were not manufactured piecemeal, you know.
Okay.
They were mass produced. All we did, Willie Ajigu, Edmund Kaini, and myself, we formed RAP.
The three of you?
Yes. We formed RAP even before independence of Biafra. We formed RAP immediately when it was clear that Nigeria must attack.
And you saw where we were, you people saw where we were going. And
Willie Ajigu, being an honest man, he found out from Major Soki. That Biafra had no weapons.
Okay.
We had only 400 guns. Because the Northerners who were stationed in Enugu
carried them
when they were going. So it was Willie that now said that thought about having RAF. Then he mentioned it to Kaine, and then they came to me. They came to me because I was the only metallurgist and metal engineer. So, and then most of the weapons were made of steel. That's the at that time, I was already with the militia.
Okay, we are already enlisted.
Yeah. So, we must produce them. Because after the business, we put a team, teams, not a team, in Enugu, put teams in Port Harcourt, and Port Harcourt railways. And put teams in a post authority.
They kept up
with number. We had thousands of hand grenades even left over. We had many mortars left over. You remember, in the newspapers published that they dug out mortars in Enugu, which were buried there. Those we couldn't carry, we buried
them. Just buried them.
I buried a lot in Amudem, one school there.
Wow. Have they been exhumed?
By whom? I didn't say.
Well, you were just rounding up on what happened, that rocket that they got.
Yes.
The boy came in, we're still waiting.
That boy had only city and guilds.
Yes.
He didn't get. He came in there, we asked him what. He said, sir, he was very nervous. He said, sir, I know why that those rockets didn't work.
You almost slapped him and
drunk. We thought they were drunk. A very small boy. Yes. Must have been about 20. Somehow, he struck me. He said, okay, let's listen to him. The boy brought that some of the rockets and showed us that the fins are the part of
the fins.
Yeah. They were not symmetrical. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Let's say a fin comes here. The next fin takes off on here. Another one takes off.
So there was resistance.
So, and that, those fins are stabilizers.
Yes.
They're the stabilizers. They make the rocket spin in one direction.
Yes.
So, since they were not symmetrical, some would take to turn this way, the other one would take to turn that way, and the thing came back.
Now, why?
Immediately said it, everybody knew it was the correct reason. And Willie Ajigu blamed himself very much. All those ones we were testing, we had taken a lot of time to manufacture them, to design.
Yes.
But what happened now was, when we were to demonstrate it, and Jude Soki gave us a very short time,
yes.
Willie Ajigu decided to make new rockets.
Okay.
But Sir, there will be no question of any confusion. Maybe gunpowder that being stuck in the older ones. He made new rockets, and because of the speed it was made, those things were not symmetrically disposed.
Try it. Let's shake.
So we praise this boy to high heaven. Give him presents. After that, now, we take rockets flying and we send them to the war front. But it was not our main rocket. The main rocket came later. And that was what we christened it Holy Moses.
Holy Moses.
Holy Moses. Because when we tested it, we were not expecting it to go so far. The thing went about 8-point-something miles.
Can you just imagine such a delivery?
And it just went straight. Okay. And when Iraq started sending rockets to Israel,
yes,
they scored missiles.
Yes.
It was exactly like a rocket. But our rocket body looked better than their own.
And predated their own by how many years? If Nigeria had continued to research on this delivery system, it's a tragedy.
No problem.
So that is where we're going to end the interview.
Well,
that is which we can use. We are going to continue the part two interview with Mr. Chidi. Thank you very much.
Excuse me.